The parsha today is Shemot, which means names. All right, Exodus, Shemot. Everybody hear that okay? Okay. Chapter 1 and verse 1. Now these are the names of the sons. The name Israel, who came to Mitzrayim, Egypt, with Yaakov, Jacob. They came each one with his household. Reuben, Simeon, Levi, and Yehuda, Issachar, Zebulun, and Benjamin, Dan, and Naphtali, Gad, and Asher. And all the persons who came from the loins of Jacob, the seed of Jacob, were 70 in number, but Joseph was already in Mitzrayim in Egypt. He was already there. If you add those up, I think you'll come up with the number 12 sons of Israel. We know that Jacob was given a name, and we know that he met the angel in the past parsha on the road to have a visit with his brother Esau to make an agreement of peace with him. But he was in the struggle of his life on that road. He knew that all he wanted to do at that point in time was to kill him. Sometimes we have to get desperate with God, knowing that without a miracle of God, we may be dead, or we may be financially depleted or broke if he doesn't come through. Sometimes we have to get desperate to really grab a hold of God and hold on to him in prayer and not let go, to get in a wrestling match with him and not let go until he blesses us, until he, in other words, gives us the answer we need to change our life. And sometimes in the process, we may get our thigh out of joint. We may have some kind of impediment left that we have to go through in the natural to remind us of the encounter that we had with the creator of the universe. Has anybody had it yet? Hallelujah. I see one. If you haven't, you need to have it. Because a lot of people are born again. They come to faith in the Messiah, but they've never really had that super encounter with God that will change the perspective of how they look at things. When you have that encounter with God, you'll never be the same again. It won't be about you anymore. It won't be about how you got hurt or who done what to you or how I was treating you. It'll be a smile on your face through the thick and the thin for the glory of God. That's the encounter that we all need to have. Hallelujah. We need a name change. Do you know he's going to give us a name change? His name was Jacob, which meant supplanter, deceiver. He manipulated to get his way. And we need to understand that he was a part of the family of God. He was the third patriarch of those who would be chosen to send the good news to the lost and dying world and bring the light of God to the world. But he still lived in a fleshly temple that needed to be brought under subjection. How many knows that we got a warfare going on in the spirit and flesh today?
Amen.
Anybody got that warfare going on?
Amen.
If you have, the best way is to get on your knees, get a hold of God, and have a super encounter. If you're having a hard time getting that encounter, maybe you need to pray and ask God to send something your way to cause you to have to do it. Hallelujah. But you better be ready when you pray that prayer, because it may not be pleasant. Amen? Hallelujah. I just wanted to preach just a little bit before I read. Now, let's read it again, verse 5. And all the persons who came from the loins of Jacob were 70 in number, but Joseph was already in Egypt. And where was he already in Egypt? Mitzrayim, the place that will become, while it's a blessing to start off with, it will become spiritual bondage and slavery. America has been an awesome place, and in a lot of respects, it still is. I don't know where God's at with America. I know that we need to have a lot more things happening that happened with the county here that Sister Melissa talked about. We in dire straits because America as a whole has turned its back on God. America as a whole, things may have to happen here bad enough in the future as we're preparing and God's preparing all of us to make Aliyah at some point in time. You understand this is not our permanent place of residency. This is a place to share the good news of the light, the aura of Messiah until Messiah returns. We have a big job to do. But I want you to know the good news is we're not going to be left here in this situation forever, because Messiah is going to return and he's got us a place of promise. We have an inheritance in the land of Israel. Sister Tracy is fixing to go and spy out. She's going to view her inheritance. I got a feeling when she comes back, she's going to be so excited she won't want to come back. But until God is ready, we have a job to do right here in the bar. We are here to win those who have ears to hear and eyes to see, to come and bring them into the kingdom of God. Amen. Through our witness, through our lives, and the things He's called us to do. And Joseph died. Joseph died, and all his brothers and all that generation. Every last one of them died outside of the promised land. They died in the land of Egypt, Mitzrayim. Where are we at today? Those of us who are in Yeshua Messiah, whether we came to Him as a Jew or a Gentile, He is the Jewish Messiah. And yes, every Jew's got to come to Him the same way every Gentile does. Amen. Where are we at? We're in the nations of the earth. Only part of our brethren are over in Israel. And God's got to do a work over there and clean up some stuff that ain't right over here. Because I can promise you, you go visit, and you've never been before, there's a lot of stuff that ain't right. God's going to do judgment. And where does judgment begin first? In the house of Elohim. In the house of God. Why? Because we don't get it right. If He doesn't get us in order, how are we going to be able to help the rest of those people out there? Judgment. His judgment's on us. He chastises whom He loves. As a good dad would chastise a child. Why? Not to be mean, but to bring him into a closeness, a relationship, a loving relationship that brings him shalom in their life, that brings him blessing and peace in their life. That's the whole purpose of God, is to teach us His ways. If we get out of order during the process, to put a little spanky-spanky on our little backy-backy and bring his backy in him. I hope everybody got that that's listening on the film there. You understand? That's a simple way of putting it. That's what we do. We don't. If you spank your children out of harshness, you're doing it the wrong way. You won't win them. You won't do. You won't accomplish what you're saying. You got to do what you do only out of the spirit of love for their good. To teach them God's right ways. Amen? God has spanked me so much. I'm so grateful. I fully understand it now. My desire is not to get a spanking again, but if I need it, please do, so that I walk in the right way. Amen. It saved me a lot of hardship and a lot of trouble. But the sons of Israel, B'nai Israel, were fruitful and increased greatly. They increased greatly and multiplied. Actually, it's the same Hebrew word for both. And became exceedingly mighty, so that the land was filled with them. So here they are in the nation of Mizraim in Egypt, and they're increasing and increasing and increasing. They're over there, and even though we're spread amongst the nations of the earth because of disobedience today, God still blesses His people, and even in the midst of the nations, He still blesses us, and we still progress and become a mighty people. Now, a new king arose over Egypt, a new Pharaoh, a new king who did not know Joseph. I want to stop right here because our Brit Hadashah reading today is from the book of Acts, chapter 7. And so let's just go ahead and incorporate that right where this is. It's a good place to put it. Let's go to Acts, chapter 7. I'm going to read that one from the Tree of Life version. Acts, chapter 7, verse 17. Everybody about got it? But as the time drew near for the promise God had sworn to Abraham, remember, Abraham got a promise from God. Was it based on what Abraham would have to do? No. It was an unconditional covenant. God swore by Himself. Because if He hadn't swore by Himself, it would have failed. Why? Because we always fall short. It's God making a promise, swearing by His own self, a promise to us that no matter what, He's going to see His promise through. But as the time drew near for the promise God had sworn to Abraham, the people increased and multiplied in Egypt, until there arose another king over Egypt who knew nothing about Joseph, dealing with our people with cruel cunning. This king mistreated our fathers and forced them to abandon their infants so that they would not survive. Now, if you'll go back and do history, if you haven't read history about what's gone on in the centuries before us, then you don't understand what's happened with the Jewish people and every believing Gentile person who's been attached to the kingdom of God. They go into a land, they go into a nation, God blesses them mightily. They become the head of the nation, not the tail. The nation progresses. They get all kinds of discoveries and blessings and all. And then, in enemy turn, always, they become fearful. And usually what happens a lot of times, too, is because it seems like our biggest test is when we get blessed. Oh, I pray that if God knew that if we got blessed, we'd turn away from Him, that we would get blessed that way. You understand what I'm saying? Because if the blessing is going to cause you to turn away from God, that's not what you need. But it seems like that's the test every time. That's the test that we fail. It's when we get so blessed, we forget about the kingdom of God. We quit giving. We quit doing. We keep being involved and doing the things and winning the loss. So the bottom line is usually a judgment of some type comes on and they've been expelled. If you've done your history, you understand the story. God is getting a people ready. One day, they're going to get to where they need to be with God. He's coming back for His whole body, His whole bride. Every Jew and every Gentile who is the bride of Messiah. And so it says that, let's read 19 again. Dealing with our own people with cruel cunning. This king mistreated our fathers and forced them to abandon their infants so they would not survive. We've seen this happen in the Holocaust, in the pogroms, and all the different things. We see it happen in the Crusades. Not just the Jewish people, but the believing Gentile people along with it and others. At this time, Moshe was born. Extraordinary before Elohim, before God. For 3 months, he was nurtured in his father's house. And when he was set outside, Pharaoh's daughter took him and raised him as her own son. Moshe was educated in all the wisdom of the Egyptians. And he was powerful in words and deeds. Now, this is an interesting statement in the book of Acts. Because it says he was powerful in words and deeds. And we're going to see over here, Moses has got an issue with his back. I can't speak. You know, I can't speak good. So, but he knows words and deeds. When he was approaching 40 years of age, it came into his heart to visit his brothers, B'nai Israel, the children of Israel. When he saw one of them being treated unjustly, he went to the defense of the oppressed man and avenged him by striking down the Egyptian. And he was assuming, what, the word assuming, anybody ever think about the word assuming? Does it always turn out to your advantage to assume?
No.
There's another term, we won't use it. Assuming can get us into more trouble than we can ever get out of. You don't base the things that you're doing on what you're assuming is right or wrong. You don't debase the things that you're doing, assuming that everything you read on the internet must be right because it's on the internet. Right? So it says he was assuming that his brothers understood that by his hand God was delivering him, but they did not understand. How many of you, don't nobody answer, just think back in your mind, how many of you have been so overjoyed with the zeal of God in you and you just wanted to share with everybody you come into contact with when God showed you new revelations, when He brought you from the place that you was at and where you're at now, we still got a long ways to go, that you wanted to share that with everybody and you just assumed that they would be as happy about it as you were. Anybody ever do that? Think about it. Did it turn out every time the way you thought it would turn out? Usually not. We have to live our life for God every day before these people when God chose us new truth and revelation. We have to live it sometimes for a long time before they're even willing to listen to us, especially if it's family members or friends. So don't be disheartened. So on the next day, he appeared to them as they were fighting, to his brothers. He tried to reconcile them in shalom, in peace, saying, "Men, you are brothers. Why do you wrong one another?" He was applying a principle, a Torah principle. But the one doing wrong to his neighbor pushed him away, saying, "Who appointed you ruler and judge over us? Why? Or do you want to kill me as you killed the Egyptian yesterday? Do you?" At this remark, Moshe fled because and became an exile in the land of Midian, where he became the father of two sons. That whole incident, that assumption changed Moses' life forever. But you know what? Y'all know I love it, don't you? all things work together for good to those who are called according to his purposes. He didn't say all things was good. He said they'll all work together for good. And all this is going to work together for Moses is good. It's not pleasant at the time. He's being banished. You got to understand, we got to look at this thing in perspective. Here he is. He's in the royalty of the Egyptian Empire, the powerhouse, the America of that day. And now he's on the run, all because he wanted to help his brethren over there. And at this time, they were already in bondage and slavery. Pharaoh, that king that didn't know Joseph, was already required for the children, the sons, to be killed. That's why he was put in the bush. That's why he ended up in Pharaoh's household. But you know, God's got a sense of humor, hasn't he? One of those are Israelites by the name of Moshe, would be trained. God had a purpose for him. But let me tell you something. Let me encourage you for a minute, young folks, just wanting to do it right now. If the zeal's burning in your heart right now, I want to encourage you, but not discourage you. Before Moses was ready, he was 80 years old. It's never too late if you trust God. I'm not saying you're going to have to be 80 years old. I'm just telling you that's how old Moses was. Joseph certainly wasn't that old, right? He was a young man. So it all depends on where we're at in our life and how we're living for God and our obedience to him. But he was 40 years old when it happened. He spent 40 years in Midian before he was ready to go, before he has the encounter with God at Mount Sinai. Goes back and he spends 40 more years delivering the people out of the land, preparing to go into the land. Seeing a whole generation die because after they saw all the miracles of God, they rebelled time and time again, and a whole new generation, a young generation, had to be raised up who would listen to what God had to say. Let's don't be like that. I don't have that kind of time. I really won't be able to go in. But that's okay if I don't make it. The resurrection will be just fine. I just would like to see it all happen before I have to die and be resurrected. That'd be my desire, but God, I'm not gonna have, it's gonna be God's desire, not mine. That's what we have to understand. Okay, let's go back over here where we left off in Exodus now for a moment. Verse 9. Now we're getting ready to get started. Hallelujah. I thank God we're not a 30-minute congregation. It is Shabbat all day long, and we're here for him to get the glory and the honor. Verse 9, and he said to his people, behold, the people of the sons of Israel are more and mightier than we. That's how much they progress. That's how many children they've had. Come, let us deal wisely with them, lest they multiply, and in the event of war, they also join themselves to those who hate us and fight against us and depart from the land. He's getting worried. God's blessing them so much, he wants to figure out a way to make sure they don't get any bigger. He wants to make sure he figure out a way to keep them under submission, keep a control on them. You know, you can't keep a control on God. I don't care how smart you are, how much you think you can manipulate to get your way. God is going to win in the outside and in the end of time, in the end of things. So you might as well understand that to begin with. But this Pharaoh didn't understand that. So they appointed taskmasters over them to afflict them with hard labor. Now if you go to the Hebrew and you look at that, it's really like a tax master. How many knows we got a tax master in America? It ain't got better, it's gotten worse. And I got news for you. It ain't going to get no better now. It's going to get worse. Little by little. Do you think this happened in 30 days? Do you think this happened in 20 years? This took over 400 and something years before their deliverance. The changes of kings, of pharaohs. Seeing what's happening. A tax master. It doesn't matter if they tax you from the point of charging you, taking so much of your money away that you got to work longer and harder hours, and then your wife's got to go to work to try to make ends meet. That's not God's way. That's bondage, folks. We don't even realize how easily we've been swayed into the bondage of the world system. It doesn't matter if it's hard labor or it's taxes, because you think about it for a moment. If the taxes are so high, you don't have enough left over to meet the bills at the end of the month, you got to work harder. You got to work more work. We need to trust God and get back to doing things His way. So they appointed taskmasters over them to afflict them with hard labor, and they built for Pharaoh storage cities, Pithom and Ramses. But the more they afflicted them, the more they multiplied, and the more they spread out, so that they were in dread of the sons of Israel. They were in fear of the sons of Israel. And the Egyptians compelled the sons of Israel to labor rigorously, severe labor, bondage. And they made their lives bitter with hard labor and mortar and bricks, and in all the kinds of labor in the field, all their labors which they rigorously imposed on them. Remember what they were when they went down there? They were sheep herders. They had a lifestyle, taking care of their family with sheep and the things that they did. They didn't have to do all this super hard labor like this. We need to think back. We need to get this perspective in our mind of how they've been pushed into all this hard, forced labor. Then the king of Egypt spoke to the Hebrew midwives, Ivri midwives, one of whom was named Shephara, and the other was named Pua. And he said, when you are helping the Ivri women, the Hebrew women, to give birth and see them upon the birth stool, if it is a son, then you shall put him to death. But if it is a daughter, then she shall live. They set in motion a law in the land of Egypt, a law of abortion, but they picked and chose who would be aborted and who would not be aborted. But in America, well, we've allowed them to enact a law to abort any child. The only difference is they haven't forced everybody to do it yet. They've allowed you to have a choice to choose to do it. There's always one thing, one step before there's another step. Just like the homosexual agenda now. One step before another step. They can't come in and do it all at one time, or there'll be a rebellion. We need to look and realize what Satan is doing. We need to look and realize the choices that we have made, the stands that we have not stood up to, while we have time to stand up. The laws are being changed in this nation. Systematically, they're being changed, and they're not going to be for the believer's good. Those things that are good will be called evil, and those things that are evil will be called good, and we see that now. If you don't think it's coming to America, unless America repents and takes a stand, I got news for you, it is coming. It's on its way. It's already been in place and being set forth. But the midwives feared God. You know, the only fear we're to have is the fear of our Heavenly Father, a reverent fear. Not a fear of He's going to hurt us, but a fear. A fear to believe Him, a fear to honor Him, a fear to trust Him, a fear to do things the way He has showed us we should do so that we can walk in blessing and peace. But the midwives feared Elohim, feared God, and did not do as the king of Egypt had commanded them, but let the boys live. So the king of Egypt called for the midwives and said to them, why have you done this thing and let the boys live? And the midwife said to Pharaoh, because the Hebrew women are not as the Egyptian women, for they are vigorous, and they give birth before the midwife can get to them. Good answer. So God was good to the midwives, and the people multiplied and became very mighty. Was it okay to figure out a way to not do what the authority, in that case, the king of Egypt, told them to do? Well, the Bible say, according to Romans, we're to obey the laws of the land. As long it does not conflict with the Word of God. And to murder your child is in conflict with the Word of God. God will bless you if you'll stand up to truth and righteousness when it goes against the Word of God. And it came about because the midwives feared God that He established households for them. The Pharaoh commanded all his people, saying, every son who is born, you are to cast into the Nile, and every daughter, you are to be kept alive. You know, I understand there's hieroglyphics over in Egypt showing these pictures of that time in history. when they were casting these children into the Nile River, and the alligators were eating, and the crocodiles. Now a man from the house of Levi went and married a daughter of Levi. And the woman conceived and bore a son, and when she saw that he was beautiful, she hid him for 3 months. But when she could hide him no longer, and by the way, 3 months, this is a messianic number. This is a picture of Messiah. Number three, it's a picture of life from the dead, because he's supposed to be dead, according to Pharaoh. But when she could hide him no longer, she got a wicker basket and covered it with tar and pitch. Then she put the child into it and set it among the reeds by the bank of the Nile. Now, I can hear something ringing in my ear. Noah's Ark. Noah's Ark. Pitch and tar in and out. And the ones who were obedient to God, the ones that God was going to use to reestablish the earth and the people of the earth, was in a place of safety in that ark that floated on the waters. Maybe you don't see it, but it's there. And his sister stood at a distance to find out what would happen to him. Then the daughter of Pharaoh came walking alongside the Nile, and she saw the basket among the reeds and sent her maid, and she brought it to her. Okay? As Caleb was saying, there were some things dropping on the floor. I wonder why my feet were sticking to that mat. He stepped on one. When she opened it up, she saw a child, and behold, the boy was crying, and she had pity on him. This is one of the Hebrew children. Then his sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and call a nurse for you from among the Hebrew women, and she may nurse the child for you?" So obviously Moses' sister was kind of watching along, and she saw her get the basket. So she went over there. You know, God's setting Egypt up for Moses, for the children of Israel, right here in this situation, right here. And this is what it says, "And Pharaoh's daughter said to her, 'Go ahead.' So the girl went and called the child's mother." Now you know what's so funny about this? Moses' mother is going to be raising this child for this Egyptian woman. So she's going to have a child with her. And I'll tell you what's really hilarious about it. She's going to get paid for it. She's going to get paid for raising her own son for this Egyptian woman. Isn't that deep? Then Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Take this child away and nurse him for me, and I shall give you your wages." See there? So the woman took the child and nursed him. And the child grew, and she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son. So she named him Moshe. Moshe. And said, "Because I drew him out of the water." Moshe, drawing out of the water. Mayim, Kayim, living water. Now it came about in those days when Moshe had grown up that he went out to his brethren and looked on their hard labors. And he saw an Egyptian beating a Hebrew, one of his brethren. Just read this in Acts. So he looked this way and that. And when he saw there was no one around, he struck down the Egyptian and hid him in the sand. He didn't like it, he got upset. That's not the right way to do it. You know, Moses is helping God out in this situation. Instead of praying about it, asking God what he wanted to do about it, he took it into his own hands. And there's going to be a string of events that take place from this, just like Abraham and Sarah decided to help God by the midwife. We see this all the time. We see there's still issues that have been passed down in the family. We've got to quit trying to get ahead of God. We need to learn how to wait on God when he speaks to us. But it's taking too long. I think maybe I just missed out. If you do what God says, you won't miss out. He will prepare the way. He will have the right time. If you get ahead of God, you're going to have to go around the mountain again. And when you go around that mountain again, it's going to be harder the next time. So he looked this way and that, and he struck, and when he saw there was no one around, he struck down the Egyptian and hit him in the sand, and he went on out the next day, and behold, two Hebrews were fighting with each other. And he said to the offender, "Why are you striking your companion?" But he said, who made you a prince or a judge over us? Are you intending to kill me as you killed the Egyptian? Then Moshe was afraid and said, surely the matter has become known. When Pharaoh heard of this matter, he tried to kill Moses. But Moshe fled from the presence of Pharaoh and settled in the land of Midian, and he sat down by a well. Now the priest, and this is interesting, because it's a priest of Midian, had 7 daughters, and they came to draw water and fill the troughs to water the father's flock. Then the shepherds came and drove them away. But Moshe stood up and helped them and watered their flock. Anybody seen the picture of Moses? You know, depends on which brand you saw. It shows him fighting against the shepherds and running them off. When they came to Reuel, their father, he said, why have you come back so soon today? So they said, an Egyptian delivered us from the hand of the shepherds. And what is more, he even drew the water for us and watered the flock. Now, there's two things I want to think about right here for just a moment. Yosef, or Joseph, when he got put in charge of second in command of Pharaoh in the land of Egypt, he got a new name, he gave him a new name, and actually the name, the Egyptian name was given, meant the bread man, because he would provide life sustenance. Picture of Yeshua the Messiah. But he looked like an Egyptian. His head was shaved off. He had Egyptian clothing on. He looked so much like an Egyptian that when his brothers came, they did not recognize him. I'm sure that by now that Moses kind of looks the same way. Two people from the house of Israel, later on, who were in the house of Egypt, who got placed in there for a purpose, each time to deliver God's people. God's people from starvation, so they can become from 70 people a mighty nation in the land of Mizraim, Egypt. And now Moses, who would ultimately, because they would not get out when they should have got out, would ultimately, while this nation was being raised up in the midst of this nation, this pagan nation, would be sent as an Egyptian, who looks like an Egyptian, because they're saying he's an Egyptian, because he looked like an Egyptian when they saw him. He didn't look like a Hebrew. And so he's going to deliver them from the bondage that they've been in. See the parallels there? And he said to his daughters, where is he then? Why is it that you have left the man behind and invite him to have something to eat? And Moses was willing to dwell with the man, and he gave his daughter, Zipporah, to Moses. So here we have Moses in another place. He's been given a wife, Zipporah. Then she gave birth to a son and named him Gershom. For he said, I have been a sojourner in a foreign land. He's in a foreign land from a foreign land. Still not in the promised land. God set him up. Now it came about in the course of those many days that the king of Mizraim, the Pharaoh, died, and the sons of Israel sighed because of the bondage. And they cried out, and their cry for help became, and their cry for help because of their bondage rose up to God. They got, you know what, it had to get severe on them. It had to get hard on them for them to start crying out to God. Now, let's look at this picture just a moment. From the time that they first went down there with Joseph, they were put in the best of the land. They had the best of the land. They had the best of everything. And Joseph was second in command only to the Pharaoh. Until that king, another king arose, he died and didn't know Joseph. This systematic beginning of taxation, if you will, to become a tax master of them, again to systematically put them into slavery and bondage. Everything was good. The Babylonian captivity in 70 AD, excuse me, not 70 AD, the Babylonian captivity that took place in Babylon for 70 years. When it came time for them to go home, make Aliyah, the Babylonians were defeated. And the Medes and Persians came in, and they were released according to the prophecy after 7 years of being in bondage. Guess what? A small minority went back to Israel because they knew that they were going to have to build the walls back. It had been torn down. The temple had been torn down. They were going to have to work with a hammer in one hand and a sword in another hand to keep the enemies off of them. The majority stayed in Babylon. You know what? Because it was like America. They had nice homes. They had good jobs. I wonder, ask yourself, if Mashiach was the sin to call today, we could go ahead and make Aliyah, would you be willing to go? Would you be willing to leave all that you have behind and get on board the ship or the plane or ever how you decide to do it? I know he's coming back with a shout at the very end of things, but people's been making the Aliyah for years now. Systematically from the nations, Aliyah has been made while we're speaking right now. I don't know how all this plays out in the end. I'm just proposing a question. Where is your heart really at in your relationship with God? Is it in such a place that whenever God's ready for you, whether it's at the resurrection after you die, or if it's when the great shofar sounds, I believe hopefully in the near future, or if you get an opportunity to, as a forerunner to go, would you do it? Would you be willing to do it? Ask yourself that question. If the answer is no, then you need to pray and ask God to help you to understand why you don't have the zeal and the understanding of your relationship with Him, that if you had the opportunity to go to the land of promise, you're not willing to go yet. It may not be your time to go yet, so don't misunderstand what I'm saying, but we should be pressing toward the point of Messiah's setting up His earthly kingdom and His return. Do we have that desire or not? Ask for the desire if you don't have it. So God heard your groaning, and God remembered His covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And God saw the sons of Israel and took notice of them. Why did I say all that? Because right now, we still got it good. We still got it good. Why would we want to change something when I got a nice house, a nice car? Maybe we got a little money in the banking account or something. Maybe we don't. But the bottom line is the poor people in this country has got it better than most people in the third world nations that aren't even considered poor. They're fairly well off. Where's our heart? It's a heart issue. Everything we do for the glory of God is a heart issue. Our relationship with Him. Our intimacy with Him, that no matter what He requires of us to do, whether it's framing out here or taking up or the bread and wine, passing that out, or doing the projector, or whatever it is we're doing right now, are we doing it with our whole heart? Are we doing it with a heart of servitude, with a smile on our face and thanking God for just allowing me to take the garbage out, if that's my job? Let's give it our all to God, no matter what it is we're doing. Because He said we're faithful in a few things, He'll make us rule over many things, larger things. So many people want to do the large things, but they don't want to do the little jobs it takes to get there. The reality of it is, if God just blessed me with a lot of money, I'll just give a lot of money, just pay for this and get it done. No, you won't. If you won't give to God what little bit you got now, you're just kidding yourself if you think you'll give. The temptation will be so large that you might not even come back in the door. You might go buy that big old sailboat you wanted. You know, I don't know what it is you might want. I've seen this happen over and over again. You got to be faithful for where you're at right now. We have to be faithful for where we're at right now, what place we're at right now, wherever God's put in our path. When God called me, it was our anniversary, wasn't it? The other day, 14 years in Am Israel? Did y'all know that? Hallelujah. I want you to come, and I want you to just lead a Bible study at the house. I was scared to death. I was shaking in my boots. I had no boots on my shoes. I'm telling you the truth. I was scared. But God said, I'm opening the door. I want you to go over there. And so I prayed, said, okay, I'll go, but you're going to have to help me. It's like, Moses, I'm scared to go. I wanted to, but I was scared. And so I went, and I come up with this saying. I said, God, Abba Father, wherever you call me or you ask me to go, I'll show up for the job. You'll have to help me, but I'll show up for the job. Look, you may not know how to do the job, but if He gives you an opening, an opportunity, don't you understand He's asking you to do something? Show up for the job. Amen. Do what you can do and trust Him to show you the rest and it'll happen. That's how he does it. He wants someone who's faithful and with a willing heart. He doesn't care about how many degrees you got, how much knowledge you got, and how much money you got, how nice you dress. Now, all those things can be important in the kingdom of God, don't misunderstand, but they're all secondary. He's more concerned with wherever you're at in your life. If all you got is a ragged pair of jeans and a shirt, and he says, I want you to go over here and do this, go do it. Go do it. It will change your life. Hallelujah. Chapter 3, verse 1. Now Moshe was pastoring the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the west side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God, the mountain of Elohim. And the Malach, or angel of Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, the Lord, appeared to him in a blazing fire from the midst of a bush. How many know that our Elohim is a blazing fire? He's a consuming fire. He can consume, or he can allow you to be in the fire and not even be hurt, like the Hebrew children in the fire furnace. Because he is the fire of God. He can consume you or preserve you. And the angel of the mountain of Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh appeared to him in a blazing fire from the midst of the bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush was burning with fire. Yet the bush was not even consumed. It was not hurt. So Moshe said, I must turn aside now and see this marvelous sight. Why the bush is not burned up? That got his attention. I think that maybe if we walked out the door and those tables had fire all over them and they weren't melting, that might get our attention. What do you think? God doesn't always do it that way to get our attention. He does a lot of little things to get our attention. When Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, the Lord saw that he turned aside to look, God Elohim called to him from the midst of the bush and said, Moses! Moses! Is that like the movie? Is that pretty good? Okay. Can you imagine that? You're up there and all of a sudden you're looking at this and you hear a voice calling your name out. And he said, here I am. And he said, do not come near here. Remove your sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is Kodesh ground, holy ground. Set apart ground, Moses. You take the sandals off of your feet. He said also, I am the Elohim. I am the Elohim of your father, the Elohim of Abraham, the Elohim of Isaac, and the Elohim of Jacob. Then Moshe hid his face, for he was afraid to look at Elohim, at God. And Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Mitzrayim, Egypt, and have given heed to their cry because of their taskmasters, or taxmasters. For I am aware of their sufferings. He is aware of everything that happens to us. If you're a child of the Most High, he even knows every hair on your head. You may think, where is God at sometimes? I'm going through the struggle of my life. Things aren't good at home. My children are rebelling. If you love him, you trust him, it's time to get a hold of him and not let go until you get an answer. He is keenly aware of what's going on. No matter you may feel alone all by yourself, he knows all about you and everything that's happening in your life. He's trying to get you to call on him. He's trying to get you to have a more intimate relationship with him, to talk to him more. Prayer is talking to God. To talk to him on a regular basis. To pour your heart out to him. He loves you so much. He's wanting, he's waiting with his arms open. He said, I'll die with you. I'm knocking at your heart's door. If you just open, I'll come in. So I have come down to deliver them from the power of the Egyptians. I have come down to deliver them from the spiritual impediment. I have come down to deliver them from severe bondage of the evil one. And to bind them up from the land to a good and spacious land. To bring them up from the land to a good and spacious land, to a land flowing with milk and honey, to the place of the Canaanite and the Hittite and the Amorite and the Perizzite and the Hivite and the Jebusite. And now behold, the cry of the sons of Israel has come to me. Furthermore, I have seen the oppression with which the Egyptians are oppressing them. But you notice this? God didn't start saying all this. He didn't come out to Moses on Mount Sinai until they started crying out to him. Look at the text. When it got bad enough, they started crying out and calling on him. God knew they would do it, and he was already preparing the person. But he was waiting on them. God is waiting on us. He's waiting on us to give our whole self to him, to call out to him every day, to be in communion with him every day, in prayer and Bible reading, in the work of our hands that we do, in our job to be the best at what we do, to love our children, to love our wives and husbands. He wants us just to call out to him in every need that we have in all these situations and circumstances that we live in. And he will make things happen. Therefore, come now, and I will send you to Pharaoh, so that you may bring my people, the sons of Israel, the day of Israel, out of Egypt, out of bondage. But Moshe said to Elohim, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh, and that I should bring the sons of Israel out of Egypt? And he said, certainly I will be with you, and this shall be the sign for you that it is I who have sent you when you have brought the people out of Egypt, and you shall worship Elohim at this mountain. He said, you're going to bring them back to this mountain, and you're going to worship me here, and that's going to be the sign that I sent you. Then Moshe said to Elohim, behold, I am going to the sons of Israel, and I shall say to them, the Elohim, the God of your fathers, has sent me to you. Now, they may say to me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? Moshe, he's in a questioning mode here. He's concerned about how he's going to handle it all. And Elohim, God, said to Moshe, I am who I am. I am who I am. And he said, thus you shall say to the sons of Israel, I am has sent me to you. And Elohim furthermore said to Moshe, thus you shall say to the sons of Israel, Yodivavheh, the Elohim of your fathers, the Elohim of Abraham, the Elohim of Isaac, Sack, and the Elohim of Yaakov or Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and this is my memorial name to all generations. So then, after he tells him that, he tells him his memorial name for all generations. And the things we'll see as the parsha begins next week, he will let us know. In fact, I'll just flip over real quick. Because in chapter 6, and we'll read this again next week in the parsha next week, when he's talking with Moses, verse 2 and 3, Elohim, God spoke further to Moses and said to him, I am Yodivavheh, the Lord. And I appeared to Abraham, Isaac, and Yaakov as El Shaddai, God Almighty. But by my name, Yodivavheh, I did not make myself known to them. What's he saying over here later on? All of our three patriarchs, just knew him as El Shaddai, God Almighty. He hadn't revealed the memorial name Yodivavheh to him yet. Go and gather the elders of Israel together, verse 16, and say to them, Yodivavheh, the Elohim of your fathers, the Elohim of Abraham, Isaac, and Yaakov, has appeared to me, saying, I am indeed concerned about you and what has been done to you in Egypt. So I said, I will bring you up out of the affliction of Egypt to the land of the Canaanite and the Hittite and the Amorite and the Perizzite and the Hivite and the Jebusite, to a land flowing with milk and honey. He said, I will bring you up to this other land where all these other people are at who've already got a place that there's just an abundance of food, abundance of housing. And they will pay heed to what you say, and you will, and you with the elders of Israel will come to the king of Egypt, and you will say to him, Yodivavheh, the Lord God of the Hebrews, has met with us. So now please let us go a 3 days' journey into the wilderness that we may sacrifice to Yodivavheh, the Lord our God. Now I want to back up just a little bit more, and I want to go back up to verse 16 a minute. I want to point this out, that Moses is not doing this all by himself. God's with him. He's telling him what to do. He says, go and gather the elders of Israel together. First of all, he tells them, you go get the elders together with you. Because these elders were of the households of the sons of Israel, sons and daughters of Israel. They were already there in the land. They still had their identity. They knew who they were. They were in a pagan land with pagan practices, but they were still intact as the sons of Israel. And it says, Yehovah, the Lord God of your fathers, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, has appeared to me, saying, I am indeed concerned about you and what has been done to you in Egypt. So he doesn't go to the whole crowd. They go and gather the elders, and he lets him know what God has spoken to the elders to him. So I said, I will bring you up from out of the affliction of Egypt to the land of the Canaanite, and the Hittite, and the Amorite, and the Perizzite, and the Hivite, and the Jebusite, to a land flowing with milk and honey. God said he's going to do all this for us, speaking to the elders. And they will pay heed to what you say, and you with the elders, and you with the elders, Moses, you with the elders of where? Of Israel, will come to the king of Egypt, and you will say to him, the Yehovah, the Lord, the God of the Hebrews, has met with us. So now, please let us go a 3 days' journey into the wilderness, that we may sacrifice to Yehovah, the Lord our God. But I know that the king of Egypt will not permit you to go except under compulsion. He said, I want you to go do this. And I'm going to tell you before you go and do it, he's not going to let you do it. That don't make too much sense to the natural mind, does it? But that's what God told him to do. See, we got to do what God tells us to do according to his word, whether it makes sense to our flesh or not. Because God's not going to tell you to do something that's in his word that's not going to be beneficial for you and I. You know, he told them, this is what you can eat. This is what is for food. Don't eat the rest of it. You don't hear him question, well, why not? There's times we have to trust God when he clearly tells us in his word what we need to do. Now, you know, later on, a lot of times we learn why. We know certain things that we're not supposed to eat. I'm just throwing this in there. They're bad for our health. They will tear down and destroy the body, which is the temple of God, which profanes the temple of God. That's just one little thing of when God tells us, don't do this, don't do that. You know, we may not understand all this for our own benefit. So I'll stretch out my hand and strike Egypt with all my miracles, which I shall do in the midst of it. And after that, he will let you go. He's saying, I'm going to do all these miracles. I'm going to do a bunch of things. He's not going to let you go for a while. But at the end, when the final miracle takes place, he's going to let you go. He'll be glad to let you go. And I will grant this people favor. He said, I'm also going to grant this people here the Israelites favor in the sight of the Egyptians. And it shall be that when you go, you will not go empty-handed. When they left, they razzed Egypt. They took the gold and the silver and the precious articles. They were glad to give it to them, to tell them, I hope that you take this and it does you great. Please take it and go now. God has a way of getting things done. But every woman shall ask of her neighbor, and the woman who lives in her house, articles of silver and articles of gold and clothing, and you shall put them on your sons and daughters. Thus you will plunder the Egyptians. Says it right there. Then Moshe answered and said, what if they will not believe me or listen to what I say? For they may say, Yehovah has not appeared to you. And Yehovah, the Lord, said to him, Moses, keep it on. All right, what about this, O God? What about this? What is that in your hand? And he said, a staff. Then he said, throw it on the ground. So he threw it on the ground, and it became a serpent. And Moshe fled from it. But Yehovah, the Lord, said to Moshe, stretch out your hand and grasp it by the tail. So he stretched out his hand and caught it, and it became a staff in his hand. That they may believe that Yehovah, the Lord, the God, the Elohim of their fathers, the Elohim of Abraham, Isaac, and Yaakov, has appeared to you. And Yehovah, the Lord, furthermore said to him, now put your hand in your bosom. So he put his hand in his bosom, and when he took it out, behold, his hand was leprous, like snow, or tsaras, like snow. Then he said, put your hand into your bosom again. So he put his hand into his bosom again, and when he took it out of his bosom, behold, it was restored like the rest of his flesh. We know that this God It's the same one that Yeshua is. Yeshua healed the lepers. Yeshua did all the healing, all the things that God would do when he came as the Son of God, as the Son of Man. And it shall come about that if they will not believe you or heed the witness of the first sign, that they may believe the witness of the last sign. But it shall be that if they will not believe even these two signs, or heed what you say, then you shall take some water from the Nile and pour it on the dry ground, and the water which you take from the Nile will become blood on the dry ground. Then Moshe said to Yehovah, the Lord, please, Adonai, I have never been eloquent. Here he goes. Neither recently nor in time past, nor since thou hast spoken to thy servant, for I am slow of speech and slow of tongue. That sounds kind of a little different from what we heard in the book of Acts. And Yehovah, the Lord, said to him, who has made man's mouth? Can you imagine that? Trying to give God an excuse about your mouth? Well, who made your mouth? I made your mouth. I can make whatever I want to come out of that mouth. Or who makes him dumb or deaf, or seeing or blind? Is it not I, Yehovah, the Lord? Now then, go, and I will be with your mouth and teach you what you are to say. See? We'll just obey God when he calls us out. He'll give us what to do. He'll teach us what to say. The key issue is obeying him when he speaks, listening to his voice. But he said, please, Adonai, Lord, now send the message by whomever thou wilt. Oh, that was not good. Then the anger of Yehovah, the Lord, burned against Moshe, and he said, is there not your brother Aaron, the Levite? I know that he speaks fluently. And moreover, behold, he is coming out to meet you. When he sees you, he will be glad in his heart. And you are to speak to him and put the words in his mouth. And I will be with your mouth and his mouth, and I will teach you what you are to do. Moreover, he shall... So the reality here is, and this, don't take this totally out of context, what I'm going to say now, but he didn't say, okay, Moses, I see your point. I'll tell you what I want you to do. I want you to go over here to such and such a Bible college for 40 years. And I want you to take speaking classes, and I want you to do this, and I want you to do that. And then I want you to come back here in 4 years, and maybe you'll be ready for me to send you to Mount Sinai. Is that what God said? No. Let me tell you something. God specifically calls you and sets you apart. He knows what he's doing. Because he ain't going to call somebody who can't get the job done. He's not going to call somebody who won't listen and be humble. Because we know Moses was a humble man, even though he was having a little problem right now with wanting to do this. God's able to meet the need. Moreover, he shall speak for you to the people, and it shall come about that he shall be as a mouth for you, and you shall be as an Elohim, a God to him. The word there, the reality to his brother Aaron, is that he would be as a God to him. The Hebrew word is Elohim in the context of the setting. Didn't say he would be God, but he would be as a God to him. And you shall take in your hand the staff with which you shall perform the signs. And Moshe departed and returned to Jethro, his father-in-law, and said to him, please let me go, that I may return to my brethren who are in Egypt, and see if they are still alive. And Jethro said to Moshe, go in shalom, go in peace. Now Yehovah, the Lord, said to Moshe and Midian, go back to Egypt, for all the men who are seeking your life are dead. So Moshe took his wife and his sons and mounted them on a donkey and returned to the land of Egypt. Moshe also took the staff of God in his hand. There's something here that's important. All the men that were seeking his life were dead. And you know, Messiah, when he was born on this earth, when he was coming here to do the work of the Father, to bring redemption to all of mankind, for a period of time, he actually went down into Egypt because in the land of his promise in Bethlehem, in the area up there in Israel, they wouldn't kill him. So they killed all the children from 2 years and under around. But he also had a visit from an angel and said, those who seek your life are dead, now it's time to go back. Again, we see these types and shadows, these pictures back and forth with these men that God are using, pictures and types of Messiah to get his job done. And so now, in the issue and the point I'm making here is it's God's timing, not ours. It's God's timing, not ours. We need to be diligent to be in prayer, seeking his face, and move when he tells us to move, and not get in our flesh and try to push things before they're ready. I'll just tell this quickly, I've shared it with some. I knew God had called me a long time ago when I was young. And I tried to go to Bible college three times. Three times. To the point of even having my house, well, the last time was having my house on the market. The realtor said, call me when you get up there to the Bible college because we've got a contract on it. This is number three, the last time. I tried. And he said, okay, we got it sold, so we made set up provisions, and mobile homes coming up, and these people were graduating, got it done. We got back to North Carolina, the deal fell through, it never did sell, and I had to counsel going to Bible college. I got to be honest with you, I was struggling with that. And I prayed, and I'm talking to God, I said, God, I thought you wanted me to do this. And you know what God said to me? Nothing. I didn't get no answer. But I knew one thing, I knew he loved me, and I knew he was real, and I knew he cared about me. I said, okay, I'm just going to go on back to work, and I'm going to wait for you to tell me what to do, because I don't know what else to do. Long time went by, a lot of things I got time to go into this. I'll share this testimony one day, it'll take a couple hours. But the bottom line is this, when God did call me to do what I'm doing today, it was totally different in anything. I never thought I'd be doing what I'm doing here. I thought I'd probably be a pastor in a church or something, the way it usually gets done. And one day I was praying, and I just kind of asked him about it. And you know what his answer to me was? His answer to me was this: I didn't want you to go to Bible college. And I'm not saying Bible college is not for other people. I'm talking about me, so don't take this out of context. If you went to Bible college, you'd have been just like all the rest of them. I want you to do it my way. And that was his answer to me. You wait on God, whether he sends you to Bible college, whether he sends you to train under some other people. You see, there's not a lot of people out there that's really got a total sold out heart to God. There's a lot more opportunities today now than there have been because God is restoring the kingdom. He's raising up leaders now. He's teaching the whole counsel of God, the whole truth. There's lots of places out there that says, Come over here because we speak the whole word of God. They don't know what the whole word of God is when you go over there. But they don't know that. So God will use people right where they're at. Wait on God. Do not get ahead of yourself. Don't force yourself into it because you end up having to backtrack and it costs you a lot of lost time and money and everything else. I hope to help somebody. If you're struggling with something. 21. We're going to take a break in just a minute, and then we'll come back to finish up. And Yod Vavheh, the Lord said to Moshe, when you go back to Egypt, see that you perform before Pharaoh all the wonders which I have put in your power, but I will harden his heart so that he may not let the people go. Now, what did he tell Moses? He said, I'm giving you power when you go to Egypt. I'm putting my power in you. He's speaking to an individual. How many of you know today that God, through the Messiah, has done something that all who believe in him and call upon him can receive that power from on high, the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit. Not just certain people, but whosoever will submit their lives to them. He said, you shall go and tarry in Jerusalem, you go to the disciples, until the promise of the Father, Shavuot, or we call Pentecost, for you shall receive power from on high that you may be what? Great evangelists. Great orators, great this and that. No, he said, you shall receive power from on high that you may be witnesses. You may fit in some of those areas that God puts you in, but the whole point here is for all of us, no matter what office we fill, is to be witnesses to those first in where? Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the othermost parts of the earth. The Great Commission, some calls it, He said, we're to share the good news that Yeshua, the Messiah, has come. He has come to deliver you from spiritual bondage that the enemy has you and the whole world under. Doesn't matter if you're in the jailhouse, the prison. Doesn't matter if you're at home, you're in a land that's free like America. It doesn't. People that don't know Messiah, who haven't accepted him for redemption and the power of the Holy Spirit being placed in your lives, you are in bondage. You're in slavery. You can have all the wealth in the world and all the cars to drive and the planes to fly, and you can still be in spiritual bondage. That's not what makes you free. But you can be like Paul and Silas was when they locked them in prison. And about midnight, they began to sing praises to God. Hallelujah. And he shook the whole place, and the cuffs fell off. The doors became unlocked, and he won out jailer and his whole family to God. We got to understand something. It doesn't matter who we have been, who we are now. It's who we need to be in Messiah. We need to trust him with our whole heart, with everything that's in us, no matter what's going on in our life. He is a miracle-working God, and he wants to show you his love for you. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Then you shall say to Pharaoh, thus says Yahweh the Lord, Israel is my son, my firstborn. You know the Messiah, be the firstborn Messiah. You're the apple in his eye. So I said to you, let my son go, that he may serve me. But you have refused to let him go. Behold, I will kill your son and your firstborn. And we know that's the 10th plague as we go through this parsha in a couple of weeks to come. That's what is the final straw that wrecks the back of the kennel, so to speak, of Pharaoh, to let the people go. Now it came about at the lodging place on the way to the Olivavhe, the Lord met him and sought to put him to death. Then Sephora took a flint knife and cut off his son's foreskin and threw it at Moses' feet and said, you are indeed a bridegroom of blood to me. So he led him along. At that time she said, you are a bridegroom of blood because of circumcision. Now Yahweh, the Lord said to Aaron, go to meet Moshe in the wilderness. So he went and met him at the mountain of Elohim, the mountain of God. He kissed him. And Moshe told Aaron all the words that Yahweh, the Lord, with which he had sent him, and all the signs that he had commanded him to do. Then Moshe and Aaron went and assembled all the elders of the sons of Israel. And Aaron spoke all the words which Yahweh, the Lord, had spoken to Moshe. He then performed the signs in the sight of the people. So the people believed. And when they heard that Yahweh, the Lord, was concerned about the sons of Israel and that he had seen their affliction, then they bowed low and worshiped. They're excited. They see that God cares about them. They see that God has sent someone to deliver them. Right now, at the point in time that this is at, they see this, and they're bowing and worshiping God. But we're going to see there's a change of attitude. You know, sometimes when we hear the word of God, that he's come, he set us free, he's sent Messiah to deliver us, to place a spirit in us, you think that that means there's not going to be any conflict after that happens? No, no, no. Just because he's going to deliver us doesn't mean it's not going to be without conflict. Doesn't mean it's not going to be without warfare and battle. We're still in the world, folks. We're in a spiritual warfare and a spiritual battle. It's going to be that way until Messiah comes. But we just need to have that relationship with him and in our heart believe and guide us to empower us by his spirit to fight through the battles, so that he will be our deliverer through the circumstances that we deal with on a daily basis. Okay, we left off at chapter 5 of Shemot or Exodus. Chapter 5 and verse 1. And afterward Moshe and Aaron came and said to Pharaoh, thus says Yahweh, the Elohim, the Lord God of Israel, let my people go that they may celebrate a feast to me in the wilderness. But Pharaoh said, who is Yahweh, the Lord, that I should obey his voice to let Israel go? I do not know Yahweh, the Lord. Besides, I will not let Israel go. He's arrogant. He's the king of Egypt, the Pharaoh of Egypt. And he's like the head of the superpower of that day. He doesn't know God. He doesn't know the Creator. He thinks he's God, in fact. In fact, he's worshipped as God. That's what we need to understand. The Pharaoh was worshipped as God. Thus they said, Elohim, the God of the Hebrews, has met with us. Please let us go a 3 days journey into the wilderness that we may sacrifice to Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, the Lord our Elohim, our God, lest he fall upon us with pestilence or with sword. But the king, the Pharaoh of Egypt, said to them, Moshe and Aaron, why do you draw the people away from their work? Get back to your labors. Again, Pharaoh said, look, the people of the land are now many, and you would have them cease from their labors? So the same day, Pharaoh commanded the taskmasters, or taxmasters, over the people and their foremen, saying, you are no longer to give the people straw to make bread as previously. Let them go and gather straw for themselves. So they're going to get punished. They're going to get punished for trying to obey God by the enemy. God's not doing it. The enemy's doing it. We need to understand when we obey God, when we come to God, some people's got out, well, if you just come to Yeshua, if you just come to Jesus, get right with him, everything will be all right from now on. Don't kid yourself. The fact of it is, a lot of times the enemy's going to attack you like ever before, and I'm going to tell you why he's going to do it. Because he had control of you, and now he's lost you. He's lost you out of the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light, and he wants to impose on you as much as he can to get you back. So this is the deal. But the quota of bricks which they were making previously, you shall impose on them. You are not to reduce any of it, because they are lazy. Therefore, they cry out, let us go and sacrifice to our Elohim, to our God. Let the labor be heavier on the men, and let them work as it is, that they may pay no attention to false words. So the taskmasters of the people and their foremen went out and spoke to the people, saying, thus says Pharaoh, I am not going to give you any straw. You go and get straw for yourselves, wherever you can find it, but none of your labor will be reduced. So the people scattered through all the land of Egypt to gather stubble for straw, and the taskmasters or taxmasters pressed them, saying, complete your work quota, your daily amount, just as when you had straw. So not only are you going to complete the same amount, you're going to have to go out and get the straw to do it with too. Moreover, the foremen of the sons of Israel and Pharaoh's taskmasters had set over them were beaten and were asked, why have you not completed your required amount, either yesterday or today, in making brick as previously? So now on top of that, they're getting beaten. The guys, the foremen that's over them are getting in trouble. They're getting whipped. Then the foreman of the sons of Israel came and cried out to Pharaoh, saying, why do you deal this way with your servants? There is no straw given to your servant. servants, yet they keep saying to us, make bricks, and behold, your servants are being beaten. But it is the fault of your own people. But he said, you are lazy, very lazy. Therefore you say, let us go and sacrifice to Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, the Lord. So go now and work, for you shall be given no straw, yet you must deliver the quota of bricks. And the foreman of the sons of Israel saw that they were in trouble, because they were told, you must not reduce your daily amount of bricks. When they left Pharaoh's presence, they met Moshe and Aaron as they were waiting for them. Here's the men of God. Here's the men that God called to deliver them. And now they're being beaten. Their workloads have been made heavier. And they're kind of upset. Remember, just a few minutes ago, at the end of verse 31 of chapter 4, let me read it again. So the people believed in Moses and Aaron and what God had sent them to do. And when they heard that Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, the Lord, was concerned about the sons of Israel, and that he had seen their affliction, then they bowed low and worshiped him. Now let's see what happens. And they said to them, to whom? Moses and Aaron. May Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, the Lord, look upon you and judge you, for you have made us odious in the sight of Pharaoh, in Pharaoh's sight, and in the sight of his servants, to put a sword in their hand to kill us. So they're upset with Moses and Aaron. Things don't go the way people think they're going to go. They can't get God, and they can't talk to him directly, so they always pick on the servants of God that he sent. They're the ones that get it. Then Moshe returned to Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, the Lord, and said, O Adonai, why hast thou brought harm to this people? Why didn't thou ever send me? So Moses is kind of upset too. He said, look, You sent me. I've done what you said. But, you know, it's not happening the way I thought it was going to happen either. Ever since I came to Pharaoh to speak in thy name, he has done harm to the people, and thou hast not delivered thy people at all. Then Yodibafe, the Lord said to Moshe, now you shall see what I will do to Pharaoh. For under compulsion he shall let them go, and under compulsion he shall drive them out of this land. God spoke further to Moses and said to him, I am Yodibafe, the Lord. So, it's interesting because God had already told Moses how he was going to do this and what he was going to do. But, when it didn't go real good for the people, and they come get up to Moses about it, and Moses goes to God about it, he's losing his patience a little bit too, not willing to wait. So God's got to reconfirm to him that I'm going to do what I told you I was going to do. Let's go to Jeremiah real quick, and we'll finish this reading up. Jeremiah chapter 1. We are in spiritual warfare. Things are not always going to happen the way we want them to happen. They're not going to always be easy. We must trust God in all circumstances that we're involved in. Jeremiah chapter 1. The words that ring, the words of Jeremiah, the son of Hilkiah, of the priest who were in Anathoth, in the land of Benjamin, to whom the word of Yodibafe came in the days of Josiah, the son of Ammon, king of Judah, in the 13th year of his reign. He came also in the days of Jehoiakim, the son of Josiah, king of Judah, until the end of the 11th year of Zedekiah, the son of Josiah, king of Yehuda, until the exile of Jerusalem in the fifth month. Now the word of Yodibafe, the Lord, came to me, saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I have appointed you a prophet to the nations. So what's God saying? This is a real good case of scripture that can be used for the abortions. That until the baby's born or until the baby's a certain age, it's not really a baby. It's not really a human life. God said, I knew you before I even formed you in the womb. I knew you when you was in the loins of your father. So God already knows who's going to be. I wonder how many babies have been aborted. There would be scientists. It would be ministers of the good news. There's no telling how many people that has been aborted because of the murder that goes on in this country called abortion. Because people are, well, I'll just get an abortion because it's not going to be convenient now. I'm going to go to college. Well, you know, my thought is this, is that if you would be promiscuous the way you are and disobey God the way you did, you would be pregnant to begin with. So the point here is that God says, I know you before you're even formed in the womb. He says specifically to Jeremiah, but God knows all things about everybody. Then I said, alas, Adonai Elohim, Lord God, behold, I do not know how to speak because I am a youth. But Yodibafe, the Lord said to me, do not say I am a youth, because everywhere I send you, you shall go. He's talking to Jeremiah, kind of like he talked to Moses. Like he's really trying to get us to understand, when I send you, you need to go. And all that I command you, you shall speak. Do not be afraid of them. And the point here is, all that God commands them, they're to speak. He doesn't want us to speak our own word. He doesn't want us to say our own thing and go our own way. In fact, that's what the prophet says about the Shabbat. On the Shabbat, we're not to do our own thing, go our own way, speak our own word. A lot of people still haven't fully understood the impact of Shabbat yet, about buying and selling on Shabbat. You know, and about going, well, you know, my way of resting on Shabbat is going to the mall and shopping. My way of resting on Shabbat, and I know I might be touching some toes here today, but you read it for yourself. Shabbat is not just the time you come to service and you go and do everything you did all like you did all before. But until you get there and you understand that, God has a lot of mercy and grace for us. I praise Him for that. But the reality of Shabbat is a day to be separated, sanctified unto God. We come together in the holy convocation of Mikra Kadesh, a time of Moedim when we come together, a Moed on the week of Shabbat, to come together to worship together, to worship Him. It's supposed to be all about Him and our love and fellowship with one another as a family before God. But Yod-Yavah, the Lord said to me, do not say I am a youth, because everywhere I send you, you shall go. All that I command you, you shall speak. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, declares Yod-Yavah, the Lord. Then Yod-Yavah, the Lord stretched out His hand and touched my mouth. And Yod-Yavah, the Lord said to me, behold, I have put my words in your mouth. He needs to put His words in our mouth. See, I have appointed you this day over the nations and over the kingdoms to pluck up and to break down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and to plant. He was given quite a mandate. And the word of Yod-Yavah, the Lord, came to me saying, what do you see, Jeremiah? And I said, I see a rod of an almond tree. Then Yod-Yavah, the Lord, said to me, you have seen well, for I am watching over my word to perform it. He said, my word will not return void. Some people may present His word when they read it with other intentions, but God's word is always going to return. It's going to accomplish what He sets it out to accomplish, irregardless of how we use it. And the word of Yod-Yavah, the Lord, came to me a second time, saying, what do you see? And I said, I see a boiling pot facing away from the north. And Yod-Yavah, the Lord, said to me, out of the north the evil will break forth on all the inhabitants of the land. For behold, I am calling all the families of the kingdoms of the north, declares Yod-Yavah, the Lord, and they will come, and they will set each all one on his throne at the entrance of the gates of Jerusalem, and against all the walls around about, and against the cities of Yehuda or Judah. And I will pronounce my judgments on them concerning all their wickedness, whereby they have forsaken me and have offered sacrifices to other gods and worshiped the works of their own hands. Who is God talking to here? He's talking to the people of God. He's talking to the nation of Israel. Who is Israel today? Every Jew, every Gentile who's come to faith in the Messiah. So what does that mean? That means there's still some within the kingdom of God, within the house of Israel, who's practicing idolatry, and they shouldn't be doing it. There's still some who's doing things they shouldn't do. There's still some who's breaking His Sabbaths, claiming to be His. And I'm not saying they're not. That's between the people and God. You can be redeemed and not know a lot of this stuff when you first get redeemed, because you've been living in a pagan culture, in a pagan world. You've got to learn that God's mercy and grace is there with you. But when you come to the knowledge and the truth of these things as you're taught by the Word of God and the Holy Spirit clearly shows these to you, you become accountable for what God has taught you. And so that's when we need to get rid of these things in our lives. Some of us still got idols. Some of us have got idols and we don't even know they're idols. Some of our idols may be our car. Certainly we all need a car. There's nothing wrong with that. But if that's all we ever do is work on our car and spend all the money we make, we get extra on our car, we don't take care of our family like we should, or it's golf, or it's hunting, or whatever. All these things are good in perspective. But we should never put any of these things before God. When you put anything before God, even if it's your wife, or your husband, or your children before God, you have to become an idolater. You have to put God first. That is the bottom line. That everything fall in line. Okay? So God's speaking to us. The Bible says it's to the Jew first and to the Gentile. All of us, by faith, have entered into the covenant through the blood of Messiah, and we are the house of Israel. Some people still like to call it and separate it, the term. And if any of y'all didn't hear the message that I had a couple of weeks ago on the radio program, pull it up in your archives, pull it up on our website and listen to it. I did a long teaching on defining the word church and synagogue and all these words and where they come from and how they're divisive and divide the body into the church is one thing and that's for Gentiles and the synagogue is one thing and it's for Jews, and that's such a bunch of baloney. The Bible, when you understand the word church was added later on and all these things were changed, The way you change history is you change words. It's been done in Black's Dictionary through the legal system for the last 100-something years. I used to have a Black's Dictionary from the late 1800s all the way through. I lost a bunch of them in the flood, and how they systematically over a period of time changed certain words, which changed meanings, which they say our Constitution doesn't read what we say it used to read. Why? Because they changed some of the legal words. We need to understand that God's word is the same yesterday, today, and forever. It changes not. God's word never changes. He never changes. We can count on what his word says. Now gird up your loins and arise and speak to them all that I command you. Do not be dismayed before them, lest I dismay you before them. Now behold, I have made you today as a fortified city, and as a pillar of iron, and as walls of bronze, against the whole land, to the kings of Judah, to its princes, and to its priests, and to the people of the land. And they will fight against you, but they will not overcome you, for I am with you to deliver you, declares Yahweh the Lord. Do you not understand it as a child of God? If we're walking in obedience to him, and we're carrying out what he tells us to carry out, and we're speaking his word and not our word, if he just told Jeremiah, they're going to all come against you. Hell's going to come against you. You're in spiritual warfare. You're not fighting against flesh and blood, but against the principalities and powers and wickedness in high places. You're fighting against the enemy of this world, the devil who wants to kill you. He's the thief that comes not but for to kill, to steal, and destroy, but Messiah came that he might give us life and give it to us more abundantly. In him, he empowers us to fight in the battle and to win, because why? He fights the battle for us. We just need to do what he says do, and he will fight the battle for us. Let's carry his word out the way he told us to. Now the Devar, or the word of Yahweh, came to me saying, go and proclaim in the ears of Jerusalem, saying, thus says Yahweh the Lord, I remember concerning you the devotion of your youth, the love of your betrothals, your following after me in the wilderness, through a land not sown. Israel was holy, set apart, or kadosh, to Yahweh the Lord, the first of his harvest. All who ate of it became guilty. Evil came upon them, declares Yahweh the Lord. So God's word is to his people for us to get our hearts right, to get our houses in order, that the Holy Spirit can empower us to reach those who are lost in darkness. If we're still operating in idolatry, if we're still doing things that we're not supposed to do, God needs to bring judgment upon us if we don't repent, so that we can get right with him, so that we can be an effective witness. The people in the world are not blind. If they see us doing the same things that they do, why do they want to waste their time listening to us? If I were them, I would not. We need to be people of love, of truth, of righteousness, always doing the right thing, even if it's our expense. If you promise somebody you're going to do something, and you made a mistake that's going to cost you, so be it. You do what you said. The words, be careful of the words that go out of your mouth. God said he's going to hold you and I accountable for every word that goes out of our mouth. So let's do what we say. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah.